Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Tonight on the SEC ESPN Network, it's non-conference college baseball. The Nicholls Colonels out of the Southland Conference meeting the nationally ranked LSU Tigers from the SEC. We warmly welcome you into Alex Box Stadium, Skip Bertman Field, with two-time College World Series champion pitcher and president of the Louisiana Sports Hall of Fame, Ronnie Rance. I'm Len Rollins. Last weekend was good for
good evening,
LSU,
everybody.
Welcome to Baton Rouge, Louisiana.
Georgia
tonight on the SEC ESPN Network, it's non-conference college competition this year. The Tigers are hitting .291 as a team, Ronnie, and Jacob Berry is at the top of the list.
Well, he's been very consistent all season long, particularly from the left side. You see that batting average, .368 with 14 homers and 43 RBI. But the switch hitter did something for the first time this past weekend. He hit a home run right-handed to dead center, .405. Hopefully, they'll get that power stroke going for him from the right side.
These Nicholls Colonels are enjoying a fine year. They took two out of three against New Orleans over the weekend. They're in a three-way tie for first place in the Southland Conference with McNeese and Houston Baptist, and Edgar Alvarez is the pace setter offensively.
Well, offensively as a team, they take a lot of pitches, they draw a lot of walks, but Edgar Alvarez, who leads the team in just about every offensive category, is their big bopper. He leads the team in homers, he leads the team in batting average, doubles, so he is a guy they want at the plate with runners on base.
Well, Ronnie, let's look at numbers between these teams. LSU offensively is better, especially in the power numbers, but Nicholls likes to steal a lot of bases.
Well, the one thing about the Colonels is their opponent's batting average is only .258, just a tick higher than LSU's. They both field around the same, Nicholls a little bit better, but they've both been very good one-run games, and that's something to watch in the later innings.
Bryce Collins gets the start on a sun-filled evening for the LSU Tigers out of Valencia, California. This sophomore is on the mound with a record of 2-1. This is the first start he's made this year after 13 relief appearances. So Collins, a 2-1 record, 2.75 ERA, 19 and two-thirds innings, 24 strikeouts. Walks have been a bit of a problem. That's somewhat excessive with 13. A liner to left field, and it's well tagged, and it's caught out there by Josh Stevenson, where the dirt meets the grass. Dane Simon with a liner out to deep left field. Here is the Nicholls batting order. There are only two 300 hitters in this lineup. Alvarez is one at 300. And then at the bottom of the order, Parker Kadu is batting .303. This is an offense that likes to generate runs with maybe two or three base hits and some action on the bases in between. Another first pitch offering, and it's fouled away. Zane Washington batting .280. He's homered six times, Ronnie, 25 RBI. That's pretty good stuff in the second spot.
Now Bryce Collins getting an opportunity to start here because he only threw one-third of an inning, Lynn, and that came on Sunday. He worked up, actually that was on Saturday rather, a third of an inning, only had one hit, two earned runs, walked a guy, so they want to get him some work. That's why he's getting the start. He'll be the first of a number of LSU pitchers today. They're hoping, ideally, he might be able to go three, maybe four. That way he would be available at the back end of the weekend.
This is a place he's never been, and that is as a starter this year for the Tigers. Swing and a miss on some high heat.
Yeah, Washington chased that one out of the zone. That fastball, 92 by Collins, ran up and in on him. Washington's second best on the team in hits with 40.
And that breaking ball catches the upper part of the strike zone. An over-the-top bender by Collins for strikeout number one and out number two. Let's take a look at LSU defensively. A pair of Joshes in the corner, Stevenson in left field, Pearson in right. Dylan Cruz is the center fielder, Jacob Berry and Jordan Thompson on the left side of the diamond. Kate Doty and Trey Morgan on the right side. And Tyler McManus is behind the dish tonight, catching Bryce Collins.
LSU's lineup, two freshmen and the rest sophomores, with the exception of Tyler McManus, the lone senior. So a very young lineup, but an experienced one because most of those sophomores have been two-year starters.
Two breaking balls in a row to Alvarez, and the count is level at one. Two outs, nobody on base. We've just started. Nicholls, one of the try leaders in the Southland Conference right now, along with Houston Baptist and McNeese, the opponent tonight for LSU. It's a hitter's wind blowing out towards center field and left center. A breaking ball is dribbled to the right side. Collins will have to field it, and Trey Morgan is there to flip it over to him for the out. A 3-1 put out, an easy inning, and we move on to the bottom of the first inning. It is Nicholls nothing. LSU coming to bat on the SEC ESPN Network.
Here to sauce things up. The internet's favorite chicken sandwich now comes with a zesty buffalo and creamy ranch sauce. Spread on our Brios buns with crunchy pickles and juicy chicken breasts. Try today.
Love that chicken from Popeye.
As a struggling actor, I need all the breaks that I can get. At Liberty Buchamel.
Cut.
Liberty Bibbidi.
Cut.
Liberty Mutual customizes your car insurance, so you only pay for what you... Line?
Need.
Action.
Cut. You can't say that.
Sorry.
Cut.
Only pay for what you need.
Liberty, 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 Liberty.
Mutual.
Cut.
Only pay for what you need.
Liberty, 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 Liberty.
Are you hungry for something good? Are you hungry for something good?
Ta-da! It's summer and sex sells, baby.
This Memorial Day,
stop.
The Belchers.
Think we got it.
Are coming.
Can you believe it?
Okay.
To the big screen.
Not what I was expecting.
Come, come see.
The Bob's Burgers movie, rated PG-13. Only.
Josh Mancuso, a junior out of Anderson, Texas, gets the ball first for Nicholls. Mancuso with a 2-0 record. This is his third start. He's had 20 and a third innings. He has walked only three. His control has been superb, and he has struck out 24. So, Ronnie, he's a strike thrower.
Hey, you see the last time out, it was exceptional against Lamar. Seven innings in length, five hits. Two runs, only one earned, but he'll be the first of a number of different pitchers today. They are not, you know, going for the, hey, we want to beat LSU to pad our numbers. They're playing for their Southland Conference Championship this weekend. And Mancuso, 6'6", 225-pound junior by way of Paris Junior College over in Texas. And the best thing that he does is that outstanding command. We're talking about a 7-1 strikeout-to-walk ratio.
Well, let's look at the starting lineup for the LSU Tigers. The first five in this order are batting 300 or better, ranging from 300 at the top by Josh Pearson to 368 by Jacob Berry. But the first five you see there, Pearson, Cruz, Berry, Doty, and Morgan, all are at or above 300. Pearson is earning regular playing time now in the outfield. And he takes a pitch high and away from Josh Mancuso.
Now the freshman out of West Monroe High School, who played for Wade Seminole in high school, has really flashed some big-time potential over the last few weeks. He has made some sensational plays in the outfield, very good defensively, and when he barrels it up, can hit the ball as hard as any Tiger.
Four homers on the year and 16 driven in. He's had 21 base hits in 16 starts prior to this one. It's a warm, windy day here in Baton Rouge. And balls hit toward left and left center field will be aided by the wind. The shift is on, and Pearson rips one through the bullpen on the right side. That skips off the top of the railing. There you see Old Glory and her teammates out in center field. Winds out of the south-southwest at 9 pretty regularly. 83 degrees right now, ideal conditions for college baseball in Baton Rouge.
Boy, if we could just bottle up tonight and let it play out the rest of the week. And boy, that pitch looked up to me. That was a breaking ball that was called a strike. And I'll tell you, this year, Lynn, we've seen more high strike breaking balls than I can really remember. I don't know if that's an emphasis by the by the umpires or what?
Simon LeBlanc and Washington defensively in the outfield from left to right. Kane and Alvarez are on the corners on the infield. Cadu and Felix are the middle infielders, and Trahan is catching. And Ronnie, back to your point about high strikes, especially on benders, I would agree with you. It is a rule book strike most of the time. That last one may have been elevated, but it is a rule book strike, but it's an interpretation that's been largely ignored for a long time in baseball.
I feel like because it's happened so often this year, there's been many pitches, a lot more pitches this year than ever, where I thought, oh, okay, that's a ball, and then all of a sudden it's called a strike on a breaking ball up in the zone. And that may be something they talked about offseason or what as far as expanding the strike zone.
Rob Schlisser is the home plate umpire. Mark Chapman is at first base. Ray Gregson is the second base umpire. And Reggie Drummer is working third base. Dylan Cruz rips one through the left side. Cruz is the first base runner as he hit that with some authority between Kane and Cadu.
Now this ball just pulled right through the five hole. About a two hopper right past the diving third baseman. And as the weather has started to heat up, so is the middle of this lineup. The good LSU hitters, Dylan Cruz coming off of a two homer game on Sunday where he had a big weekend. He's now got 13 bombs on the year.
Jacob Berry sends one deep to center field, but it will stay in the ballpark. It's caught on the grass in deep center field, and so Berry is retired on the first pitch with Cruz remaining at first base with two outs. Believe it or not, there are only 7 stolen bases represented in the lineup tonight for LSU. Trahan, though, has not caught a base runner in 16 tries against him. So 16 times Nicholls' opponents have stolen bases without being thrown out against Trahan.
Well, everybody seems to.
Cruz is on the move. The pitch is a strike, and the throw is way to the left of the bag, and it bounced in. That one looked like it got hung up by Trahan, and Cruz has the stolen base. That's his third of the year in 4 tries. Actually, third of the year in 5 tries.
Well, the throw clearly wasn't a good one, but it wouldn't have mattered anyway. That ball was, Cruz stole that off of the pitcher, and when you've got a left-hander on the mound, oftentimes nowadays, hardly anybody reads a lefty. Now it's all first movement. As soon as you see the foot lift, you take off and you hope you just guess right.
Well, Doty is plunked as that ball bore in on him and got him on the lead leg. Tigers continue to be bruised at a very high clip this year. That's only the second batter that Mancuso has hit with a pitch this season.
And that's a pretty interesting stat. You see that LSU leads the SEC, top 10 in the country, in getting hit by pitches, which is a point of emphasis by Jay Johnson. He's kind of led the conference wherever he's been, whatever school he's been. They work on not getting out of the way of pitches with the bottom half of their body.
Trey Morgan at the plate. He has labored for quite a few weeks now with an injured leg. He normally wears a brace on it during games. And that has slowed his mentality a bit, slowed his mobility a bit.
Now you can see that brace still there under the right leg. And, you know, he's still a good player, but it has limited his range at first. And I feel like it's also limited his balance just a little bit at the plate. He's chased more pitches out of the zone than we're accustomed to seeing out of him.
Two outs, two on. Pearson struck out. Cruz hammered a single to left. Berry fly deep to center. Doty has been hit by a pitch.
Interesting matchup right here. This is a year ago. You would have said Trey Morgan's got almost 400 batting average against lefties and a pretty good chance of getting a base hit here. But this season, batting sub 150 against lefties is Trey Morgan.
Well, here are the numbers you were talking about. Last year, he hit 379 against left-handed pitchers as a freshman. This year, he's hitting 146.
Hit better against lefties than he did righties a year ago, and this year has just not figured it out at all. I mean, he has gone from the penthouse to the outhouse.
He's jammed on this one, a slow roller left side, and it is muffed by Kane. Austin Kane went to his left, but could not pick it up, and the bases are loaded.
This will be an interesting decision by the scorekeeper here, because this ball has a lot of spin on it. And it would have been an interesting play at first base, even with Morgan's big knee brace. He runs well enough to where he probably could have beat that out. So we'll see what scorekeeper rules on it.
It's an error. That ball was spinning as you described, and as Kane was going to his left, the ball took a left turn toward Kane's right, and it handcuffed him at the last moment. So the bases are loaded for Jordan Thompson. Mancuso delivers inside, ball one. Two outs and a Tiger on every base. It's Cruz, it's Doty, and it's Morgan. Ronnie Rance, Lynn Rollins with you, and we are so thankful you have chosen to be part of our audience tonight. We hope you enjoy the next few hours of baseball. Thompson lifts this one out of play. That's in the sunshine and the bleachers on the right side.
Well, giant moment for the Colonels right here. You got the bases loaded, two outs, one good pitch. You can have a lot of momentum and feel good and dodge a bullet here in the first, or Thompson can put a crooked number on the board with a swing.
There's been only one base hit, a sizzler to left by Cruz. Thompson takes a strike, and that's a nice delivery by Mancuso. Jordan Thompson, 1-for-6 this season with the bases loaded. And they are loaded with Cruz, with Doty, and Morgan. Thompson hits it left side, scooped by Kane. The throw is on the chest of Alvarez, and the side is retired. So the Tigers leave the bases loaded. We are scoreless as we go to the second inning in Baton Rouge. Nicholls and LSU.
Her unstoppable spirit changed your world. This Mother's Day, light up hers with a gift from Kay. Celebrate every mom and every kiss.
Simply irresistible. Simply irresistible.
Applebee's Irresistibles are back, now starting at $8.99. Now that's eating good in the neighborhood.
At Hampton by Hilton, hot breakfast means daddy-daughter time and waffles with extra chocolate sauce and extra giggles and extra napkins. Book our family of brands at Hilton.com. To new memories, Hilton.
Cricket's $60 unlimited plan with 5G and HBO Max is the ultimate bundle.
That's unbelievable.
No, it's...
Don't.
It's bundleivable! Smile, you're on Cricket.
Oh, you're doing it wrong, man.
What's wrong with action figures?
Nothing, except buying them without Capital One Shopping.
What's that, Samuel, Mr. L. Jackson?
Capital One Shopping instantly searches for available coupon codes and automatically applies. Just download it to your computer.
Whoa, you're my hero.
Yeah, I can tell.
You like it?
I look good in miniature. Capital One Shopping is kind of genius.
What's in your wallet?
I don't say it like that, Devin.
Welcome back, everyone. The second inning is coming your way right now. We are scoreless after one. LSU left the bases loaded in the bottom of the first inning. These teams have quite a long series history against each other. LSU has won more than twice as many games as has Nicholls. LSU has had great success lately, too, winning 8 of the last 10. against the Colonels. In fact, Nicholls' only win in the last 33 games against LSU came in 2020 in Thibodaux and 2015 in Baton Rouge. So LSU really has had its way with Nicholls for many years consecutively now.
Well, you mentioned in 2020, Nicholls knocked off LSU. How about the fact that a young freshman by the name of Braden Joubert hit a home run in that game against the LSU Tigers to help the Colonels to a victory? And now Braden Joubert playing against his old teammates today.
That's a pretty good trivia question right there. Two-two pitch, a check swing, and we will do it again at 2-2. Alec Paz, Garrett Felix, Hunter LeBlanc at the plate this inning for Nicholls. Popped up left side. Jacob Berry in foul ground makes the grab near the third base coach's box, and Collins induces a pop foul to retire Paz. Bryce Collins making his first start of the season, a 2-1 record, and a nice ERA of 2.75. Here's Garrett Felix out of Lafayette. And he is plunked. So Felix becomes the first base runner. And it looks like the 651 is right on time.
Take a look right here. Trying to go breaking ball on the outside corner. And that one just got away from him in a big way. That was like an Ephus curve. Garrett Felix was just trying to avoid it a little bit, then realize, you know what, let me just stay in here and get hit by the pitch.
That's the third time Collins has hit a batter this year. A liner to center field. Cruz coming on. He gets there to make the chest high catch. Hunter LeBlanc hit it solidly, but Cruz was able to track it down. The 651 headed north, I guess. Right on time tonight. We have not seen the usual number of freight trains this year that we normally see at the ballpark. Supply chain issues, I guess.
You're probably right.
Austin Kane hitting just above 200.
And Garrett Felix, 8 of 10 in stolen bases on the year over there at first base. That's third most on the team, and boy, that was close.
He's got a pretty good lead. McManus has thrown out only one batter this year in 10 attempts against him. 30% is about average. 35 to 40 is good. Anything above 40 is really off the charts.
I've really been surprised that more teams have not been aggressive against LSU more. You know, with Milazzo being out most of the year, and LSU's rotation are Travinsky and McManus, that are both more offensive-minded catchers at this point in their career. Surprised teams haven't taken their chances running against them.
LSU has the game's only stolen base. That was Cruz as he swiped a base for the third time this year.
I think it also demonstrates that LSU's done a nice job as a coaching staff and as a pitching staff of holding runners, picking off, changing the looks, you know, being quick to the plate when it's necessary, and that's shut down some of that running game.
A sizable lead is being taken by Garrett Felix. As a unit, the three LSU catchers have thrown out 25% of the would-be base stealers. They are 7 for 28. That's Travinsky and McManus. And, of course, Milazzo, although he hasn't played in a long time.
Oh, there's a mistake.
Yes, it is.
after all that work of holding the runners and picking off and picking off. It was just McManus had already caught that ball, it even seemed, just jumped out of his mitt.
So the passed ball puts Felix at second base, and that's the fifth time that McManus has not been able to make a play on a catchable ball.
Just kind of jumped out of the webbing of his glove. It was a changeup, and just kind of had a little rabbit in there, just jumped out.
2-1 now on a bender by Collins. LSU catchers as a unit this year have had 12 pass balls. The 2-1 pitch. Breaking ball hammered into left field. That is a foul ball by inches.
Ooh. My goodness. I thought it was fair initially, but
now this is reviewable.
That was a good look. My third base umpire, Reggie Drummer, was right on it.
By the way, just for the record, the 651 took 4 minutes to pass by the ballpark.
Hanging breaking ball right here. Collins curveballs haven't been very sharp early, and that ball, yep, clearly you can see about 6-8 inches left of the foul line.
Kane out of St. Joseph, Illinois at the plate with an RBI opportunity on a 2-2 pitch. Swing and a miss on some heat. Austin Kane strikes out. Collins has retired one by strikeout in each of the first couple of innings. As we take a look at the fastball, blowing away, and Kane could not catch up with it. We are scoreless as we go to the bottom of the second inning on a beautiful evening in Baton Rouge.
For me, being in nature and putting my hands in the ground, it's almost a spiritual experience.
I wanted to use our garden as a way to share food and love with my friends and family.
I had this idea for this other way of life, for sustaining myself.
To me, it's all reflective of my personality. It's artistic.
Join the millions of people who are finding new ways to grow this year at miraclegrow.com.
There are places I remember all my life, though some have changed. All these places, oh, I'll often stop and think about them.
You really can't get much for $5 these days. You really can't get much for $5 these days unless. Is that a real song?
I think she liked it.
Your choice of sandwich plus all this for just $5 is worth celebrating. Choose wisely. Choose Wendy's Piggy Bank.
Oh my teddy puppies!
Yeah, we all got free 5G phones from Cricket, and now we're making content.
I want to make content.
Hi.
Easy on the megapixels, buddy.
Get a free 5G phone.
Smile. You're on Cricket.
There's a new head coach in the Nicholls dugout this season. It's Mike Silva. He came over from Louisiana Tech as an associate head coach for 3 seasons. Tech had a grand year last year hosting a regional. And Silva has been a scout for the San Diego Padres. He had a year of that in 2016. So Silva has his club in a tie for third place in the Southland Conference with Houston Baptist and McNeese, and everybody is very close to the top in that league.
Well, what Nicholls has done, and right now that conference, I mean, there's not a lot of difference between first place and eighth place, but the Colonels are to be commended in a big way because their numbers don't jump out at you on paper, offense or defense. But they get on base, and they play you tough, and they bunt when they need to bunt. They can steal a bag when they need to steal a bag. They're very technically sound, and he's off to a fantastic start, Mike Silva, in his first season in Thibodeau.
Joe Bear slams a couple of pitches foul.
you know, former Colonels coach Seth Thibodeau, who was there a long time as an assistant coach, a head coach, did a fabulous job for he's now at UL Lafayette. He's moved on as the assistant head coach and pitching coach. He's doing a nice job.
Two balls, two strikes on Joubert. McManus and Stevenson will follow. Mancuso lets it fly, and Joubert lifts one up the elevator shaft in shallow center field. LeBlanc is there, and he makes the catch. Ronnie, talking about the Southland Conference, there are eight baseball-playing teams in the league this year. I like the way they are handling postseason. They are dividing the teams into four team units. There'll be two tournaments going on at the same time the first weekend in a regional format. First place team will host, the second place team will host. Then the two teams that emerge from that weekend regional format will play each other at the highest seed in a 2-out-of-3 series. And I think that's really a novel way to hold postseason, and everybody gets a chance.
Well, there's two ways of looking at it. One, I love it. I think it's thinking outside the box. I really like it. It brings a lot more excitement. But you know what it does also? It allows you to, you know, pitch your best guys. You know, a lot of times when you put eight teams in these tournaments that go on 5 days, you're starting to get down the line. You get a lot of 16, 15 scores and things like that. When you've got a 2-out-of-3 weekend series, or you're playing a four-team regional, even in a four-team regional, the most amount of games you can play is five. That ball might be out of here.
It is on a line deep to left field, and it is up against the wall. Tyler McManus is on his way to second base, and he will make it standing with a wall-banging base hit off the left field wall. That's his third double of the season.
He actually hit this ball too square. It was too much of a line drive, had too much topspin on it, because he absolutely crushes this baseball. Just didn't get under it enough, get that backspin instead of hit the topspin on it. And he doesn't hit a lot of doubles. That's only, what, his third double of the season, which is crazy for a guy who's got four homers and three triples. He's got just three doubles on the year.
Well, he likes to go the extra mile. He doesn't want to stop at second base.
It's funny that the guy who's probably the slowest Tiger is second on the team in triples.
Here's Josh Stevenson, batting 231, making his 10th start of the season. Stevenson out of Youngsville, Louisiana, in crawfish country over near Lafayette. Have the prices receded a bit?
They've gone down a little bit. You can get some raw usually around $2.99 a pound. You know, you might find a little better, a little worse, but $2.99 is a good number, and usually about $4.99 a pound for boiled already, if you don't want to cook it yourself.
So for boiled, it's about the price of a gallon of gas.
That's it.
And then less than that for live.
Now, if you sat down to eat crawfish, how many pounds would you normally do? Like normal sitting?
Minimum five.
Right.
Minimum.
Right.
Absolutely minimum. My personal record, and this was about 14 hours worth of gorging, was, I hate to even say this, back with the Lafayette Drillers, Texas League baseball team, after a game one night and an off day the next night, 26 pounds.
My goodness. Was it a contest?
No. But
it had to be an all-you-can-eat place or something. You weren't buying.
No. The team. No, of course not. Of course not. The team, this group of Cajun fans, put it all together, and all the liquid.
Wow.
Liquid.
14 hours of eating.
14 hours.
How swollen were you the next day? All that salt in your system. I'm more of a Bubba Gump guy. I like the shrimp. over the crawfish. I could do some damage on shrimp.
I love crawfish.
Delicious crawfish.
Crawfish might, if I could only eat one thing for the rest of my life, it might be crawfish. Stevenson has not had a base hit against left-handed pitching this year. He's 0 for 8. One out, a runner at second base on the wall-banging double by Tyler McManus.
Stevenson only hitting 231. It may surprise you because he seems like he's hitting better than the average would indicate. That's because he's always on base. His on-base percentage is 385, which is pretty incredible for a guy that's hitting only 231 in the season. There you see. Didn't get a hit, but he's on base, and that's all that matters.
To me, offensively, the two most important statistics among many, on-base percentage, runs driven in. Would you agree with that?
I would definitely. On-base percentage for me, number one. But you're right. RBI guys, you know, they get you in from third. They're clutch with runners on base. LSU's got 4 guys with 40 or more RBI in their lineup. That is outstanding.
Here are LSU's offensive SEC ranks, second in the league in runs per game, second in the league in slugging percentage, second in the league in on-base percentage, second in the league in doubles, and fourth with that .291 team batting average. Swing and a miss. Josh Pearson, who is 2 for 16 against left-handed pitching this year, falls behind 0-2.
Well, of all those good stats that you just saw, and LSU continuing to climb, you see second in the league in a lot of categories, they have struggled mightily against left-handers this year. And it, as a team, and we talked about Trey Morgan earlier batting 147, that average has gone down even more after the error. But just for whatever reason, as a team, they're batting 100 points lower against lefties.
That one is dumped into right center field. The runner is being waved around third. The throw is cut off on the infield. And Josh Pearson, down in the count, delivers to right center field. It found grass between LeBlanc and Washington. And the Tigers, on the RBI single by the leadoff batter, have a 1-0 lead.
Pearson jumping all over this Mancuso mistake. It was an 0-2 pitch. He hung the breaking ball. It was actually up in his eyes. And Pearson said, I'm not going to let that mistake go by. He went up and got it for a big base hit off of a left-hander.
Here's Dylan Cruz, who sizzled one through the left side last time. One out, a run in, two on base. Cruz swings and misses, and that was a really nice changeup.
Pulled the string, and Cruz almost hurt a rib. He swung so hard. He was going up there geared up for that fastball, and it looked just like a fastball, but it was 10 miles an hour slower.
Cruz smashes this one foul past third. LSU already has had 6 base runners in 2 innings. One has crossed the plate. Lynn Rollins, Ronnie Rance with you tonight. Thank you for being part of the gang. McManus has scored. Stevenson and Pearson are aboard at second and first. A slow curve dips out of the zone. That's a one hopper, and it was fielded for a moment by Kadu, but when he looked at third to try to make the play there, potentially the ball rolled out of his glove. He made a heck of a pickup, but then when he turned to look at third base, the ball got free.
Another ball just tattooed by Cruz. Second at bat, second hard hit ball on that left side. And an opportunity to make a great play. Just came up just a little bit short, did Cadu.
That smoker is going to be ruled too hot to handle. An infield hit. And for the second consecutive inning, the Tigers have the bases loaded. Here's Jacob Berry. He hit a ball deep to center field last time for out number two. This one is foul. Reggie Drummer turned into a question mark down there in foul ground to get out of the way of the ball. The third base umpire nearly got picked off.
Reggie with rocking that number 21 on his sleeve. Pretty good number there.
Will this liner be fair or foul? It is to the left of the foul line, down near the warning track.
ACJ Johnson had a conversation with him before the game and said, Coach, what do you think? 18 wins, is that the magic number for the Tigers to host a regional? He said, I think 17 is a lock. He feels like with their strength of schedule, where they'll be and what's going on around the country, he said 18 wins, we might be able to get in back end of the top eight national seeds. 17's their magic number in their mind.
Well, look at Jacob Berry. 349 against left-handed pitching, 375 against right-handers. Very, very consistent.
Now that left-handed pitching average has come up about 50 points and it's going to continue to go up.
That liner drops into center field. The Tigers play station-to-station baseball as Jacob Berry delivers the third consecutive hit for LSU. He's one for two now as he drives in yet another run. Number 44 in the run driven in category for Berry this year.
Now, Jacob Berry, you know, his batting average against left-handers has jumped over 75 points in the last couple of weeks. And he also picked up his first homer of the year on Saturday. So things are starting to improve from the right side. And how about the picture we saw of Jacob Berry taking a photo with his doppelganger, Drew Brees, on Sunday, who threw out the first pitch for in this LSU game here at the box. They had a great photo on social media that went around of Drew and Jake, and Berry. And you, I swear, you're looking at a 20-year-old Drew Brees in the photo.
We have a conference on the mound right now. Warm-up pitches are just now starting to be thrown in that Nicholls bullpen.
Already got five hits off of Mancuso through an inning and a third.
Four of them have been in this inning, a double by McManus, Stevenson walked, and then three consecutive singles by Pearson, Cruz, and Berry. Doty is another one of those Tigers who absolutely wallops right-handed pitching, but has struggled against left-handers. He's batting 213 against portsiders and 372 against right-handers. Ball one. McManus and Stevenson have scored. LSU left the bases loaded in the first inning. There's a Tiger on every base here in the second. Pearson and Cruz and Berry from third back toward first.
That was a good pitch because it was a 1-0 count. Do you know Doty wanted to be swinging, and that ball just caught the inside corner through that cutter. Doty only 1-for-5 and bases loaded this year. You know, those numbers are going to start to equal out. He might have a big hit coming right here.
He swings through a pitch. That looked like a bit of an off-speed delivery.
Yeah, pulled the string, a little straight changeup.
Doty has been a very nice clutch hitter in his LSU career.
Now, to say the least, he's been clutch. My goodness, especially this year. Walk-off homer on Sunday. Had the big clutch hits earlier this year up in Houston, or Minute Maid.
Another off-speed pitch. Couple of very good changeups take care of Doty.
Boy, how about that? Fell behind in the count 1-0, went cutter, changeup, changeup to get a really good hitter.
So Doty strikes out with the bases loaded, and this brings on Trey Morgan. Morgan reached on an error by the third baseman Kane last inning. Here we go, lefty to lefty. A breaking pitch. He is smothered by Trahan. Morgan lifts this one into foul ground. It is not playable. Two outs, two in. The bases are loaded in the bottom of the second inning. One ball, one strike to the still young LSU first baseman, Trey Morgan. Morgan has played pretty deep. And as an opposite field hitter, he shoots this one down to the shortstop, who will make the play himself. Cadu gets to second base for the force out on Berry. The inning is over. But an RBI base hit by Josh Pearson and an RBI base hit by Jacob Berry have given LSU a 2-0 lead. The third inning is straight ahead on the SEC ESPN Network.
What is this? Over 75 live channels for sports, news, and entertainment, just like cable.
Hulu has live TV.
At Hilton, let's jump in. Into memories best celebrated together. Where time away means us time. And a goodnight kiss. Where reunions become incredible nights. Where breakfast is the sweetest part of the day. Let's jump into new memories. Book now at Hilton.com.
Oh, I love sports.
Me too. That deserves a Dr. Pepper. The word you deserve.
Deserves a Dr. Pepper. The word you deserve. What? No, I love sports.
Me too. That deserves a Dr. Pepper.
The word you deserve. At Ace, your backyard is right in our backyard. So when you need to feed your grass, remove the weeds, or wrangle those leaves, go to the best. At Ace, your backyard is right in our backyard. So when you need to feed your grass, remove the weeds, or wrangle those leaves, go to the best place that delivers on top brands like Ego, Toro, and Steel. No warehouse.
Johnson just walked out of our picture as he gets set for the third inning here. First season as LSU head coach, closing in on 350 career victories. Of course, he was the Arizona head coach from 2016 through 21. And made a couple of College World Series appearances. And the Tigers right now are 29-14. As this game progresses, we'll show you some projections on where LSU may wind up at the end of the year. Bryce Collins induces the fly ball out from Trahan. And this brings on Parker Cadu. C-O-D-D-O-U, pronounced Cadu.
Of course that would be his last name because he's from Thibodaux, Louisiana, so it's got to be some kind of different spelling, pronunciation. I don't know of another Cadu. Have you ever heard of that one?
No, that's a new one on me. Skippy Cadu and Tyler, too.
I don't think that's how it went.
That's close enough. It was Tippy Cadu and Tyler, too.
Right.
Well, I just Skippy Cadu and Tyler, too.
How about Nicholls, how they stack their lineup, Lynn? They've got 200-300 hitters in their lineup. Cadu is one of them, and he's batting ninth. The only other one is Alvarez, who's in the third hole.
There's a base on balls.
Not a surprise that that's a walk for the Colonels. That's what the Colonels do very good, is walk batters in the Southland Conference. They're one of the best.
Simon at the top of the order hit the ball well and fly to left field in the first. Cadu has stolen 9 bases. He has not been caught, and he is running on the first pitch. And Simon lifts it out of play deep in the left field corner. LSU's bullpen is up with a left-hander and a right-hander throwing for the first time. That's Hasty, the left-hander. And the right-hander is Floyd. Jacob Hasty has turned into a wonderful story these last few weeks, coming out of the bullpen for the Tigers. Collins misses high.
See, LSU not afraid to pick off. You know, why not? Jay Johnson not in a hurry any other way. they take their time. You know, it's a little bit frustrating at times for the fans, but imagine if you're the other team and you keep that ball skied off to right field, be a can of corn out there for Pearson. But imagine if you are the other team and you're having to constantly dive back, it wears you out physically, mentally, to where you may say a little bit of no mas, right? Like, okay, all right, we're not going to go. And that's what Jay Johnson does. He wears you down. He's not worried about your dinner reservations. He's going to send the catcher out to the mound. He's going to change the tempo. He's going to take his time. And he's done a really nice job the last few weeks at really monitoring and controlling the game from the coaching box.
Now, Cadu has run on a couple of earlier deliveries. One was fouled out of play. The other one was caught. Cadu was able to return. Here's Zane Washington with 2 outs. Washington struck out in his first at bat.
This is, I'm sure, a situation where they're buying time. They've got Jacob Hasty warming up down in the bullpen. And if Washington reaches base, then the leading RBI producer, Alvarez, a left-hander, would be at the plate, and you'd probably see Hasty come in.
LSU has outscored its opponents in every inning this year. What would you think the most productive inning is for LSU.
I'm going to say the third.
That's actually the second least productive.
I mean, I had a 1-9 shot, Lynn. I mean, or 1-8, really.
I'll give you one more golden opportunity.
I'm going to say the sixth.
No, that's near the second, at least. It's the fifth inning.
Okay, well, I was all around.
56 runs in the fifth inning this year. That's the most by LSU in any inning. Tigers have an advantage in every inning. This is popped up and unplayable. They scored 46 in the first this year. Did the Tigers, outscoring their opponents 46-22. Closest inning is the ninth with a 17-15 advantage. Cadu has stolen 9 bases. He's been perfect on the base paths. And another throw over.
Well, as many times as Collins throws over, he has a big leg kick, and he's somewhat deliberate to the plate. He's had base runners have stolen 6 times against him this year.
Boy, that was a dandy breaking pitch. Took a lot of speed off of it as well. 1-2.
That's a high number for only 19 2/3 innings. Where at this point, you know, 22 innings plus of work this season.
Cadu has shortened his lead a little bit, but he draws a throw anyway. Five hits for LSU, and the 2 runs came in the second inning. Cadu is leaning, and he is away with the pitch. It's dribbled foul.
Well, you know, everyone in the ballpark knows that Cadu is going to go because, you know, if he does get thrown out, then you start the next inning off for Nicholls with Washington, who runs very well. It's almost like a double leadoff situation. So, you know, even if it doesn't work out for the Colonels, they're in a good shape next inning with one of their best hitters leading off.
Trahan fly to center. Cadu walked. Simon has flied out to right. Cadu is running again. Ground ball to Thompson. Jordan comes up throwing. Low throw in the dirt and not able to be plucked by Morgan. He'll get most of those, Will Morgan. But a routine throw wound up in the dirt before it got to Morgan. Another error for the Tigers.
This is about as routine gets right here. Good pitch by Collins. It's hooked. And you know, you could see right there, Thompson didn't come get the ball. He really stayed back on it, didn't kind of move through the baseball with his momentum, and then just kind of spun through. And you could tell he was thinking about it before he cut the ball across the diamond. And that throw coming up short to first base, we have seen that over and over again this year.
LSU has made the most errors of any team in the SEC and has the worst fielding percentage. And nobody really saw that coming before the year.
It wasn't even on anyone's radar. And you know, especially Thompson with the freshman year he had a season ago where he was able to play and start just about every game and all the valuable experience he earned. You know, I thought this was going to be a breakout year for him, offense and defense, but that has not been the case.
LSU defensively at times this year has been nightmarish. And the thing that's inexplicable is what we just saw to an extent, and that is an unforced error, if you will. That's going to be the end of the night for Bryce Collins and Jacob Hasty, the left-hander. We'll come out of the bullpen. So we will take a pitching change timeout right here. Nicholls is threatening. LSU leads it 2-0, but the Colonels have 2 on in the top of the third.
Okay, this is a freezer, not a time capsule. Sometimes the house itself can tell you how a young homeowner is turning into their parents.
Not those two.
Yep, they're gone.
Forever?
Yep.
That there is Progressive's Home Quote Explorer website where I compared home insurance rates.
We don't need to print the internet. Some are beyond help. I will give you $100 if you can tell me what this is.
Scotch egg.
It's a meatball.
Progressive can't help you from becoming your parents, but we can help you compare rates on home insurance with HomeQuote Explorer.
We've got a lot of work to do.
Choosing T-Mobile is like paying for this, but getting that. And so much more. More 5G bars in more places. More savings so your family saves 20% versus the other guys. And we won't raise the price of your rate plan with our cool stuff. Get more with T-Mobile. More 5G coverage, more savings, and even more cool stuff.
Jacob Hasty is the first out of the bullpen for the Tigers. This left-hander. Jacob Hasty is the first out of the bullpen for the Tigers. This left-hander has been a force out of the bullpen the last 3 weeks or so. 11 innings of work. They've all come recently. He's only allowed 5 hits. He has struck out 13. He has walked only 3. No record with an ERA of 1.64.
Well, Jacob Hasty, I saw him before the game, and I said to him, I said, man, you have been the talk of this team over the last couple of weeks, and that has been the case. He didn't even pitch till April 5th against Grambling, got some garbage time through two-thirds of an innings, struck out a batter through 13 pitches, and he went, oh, we see a little something. All right, we'll try you out against Arkansas. Well, he pitched well against Arkansas. He pitched well against Missouri. He had a nice 3 2/3 against New Orleans. He pitched 3 innings against Georgia, and now – he's accumulated 11 innings. He's only given up 5 hits, Lynn. He struck out 13, only walked 3. He's got an ERA of 1.64, and all of a sudden, Jacob Hasty, 90-92 from the left side, commanding the inside part of the plate against right-handers, and he's a viable big-time relief option for Jay Johnson at the moment.
I had a nice and elongated conversation with Jason Kelly, the pitching coach, about this young man, Jacob Hasty, because of his emergence. And I said, was he injured? Did he have some discomfort? He said, no, he just couldn't throw strikes. Said he didn't throw strikes in the fall. He didn't throw strikes in January in the run-up to the season. He didn't throw strikes in bullpen activity during the season. And he was basically relegated to the back of the bus in terms of rotation. And then, as you say, Ronnie, a couple of times in bullpen sessions, he clicked. He was throwing great strikes. They put him in the game, and Hasty has been fabulous in his work in limited duty still so far, but he has really contributed to the depth and the effectiveness of the LSU relief staff. And it's all because he is finding the plate.
Well, he's pitching with conviction, and Raleigh Cooper had the workload for the lefties. He was the lone lefty reliever that LSU was using this year. Now they've got two guys that do it a little differently.
Let's see what Hasty does here against Nicholls' best hitter, Edgar Alvarez. That's off the plate, ball one. Runners on the corners. Cadu, who has quite the baseball heritage, is at third base and Washington on first.
Yeah, Cadu, whose dad played for the Colonels, his brother played at ULM. So the Cadu family, the first family of baseball in the state of Louisiana.
Hasty delivers, and a breaking pitch divides the plate.
Brother Peyton has played at ULM. His dad, Jamie, was a former colonel back in the day.
Two outs, runners at third and first. 1-1 to Alvarez. Swing and a foul tip. Pause is in the on-deck circle, but there are two outs. A walk and a two-out error have put Colonels on the corners. Hasty from the chest. Kicks and delivers. Swing and a miss on a big bender, and Hasty comes out of the bullpen and strikes out the best Nicholls Colonel with a bat in his hands. Runners are left at third and first as Hasty gets the job done on this big breaking pitch. 2-0 LSU. We go to the bottom of the third.
Got this feeling down deep in my soul that I just can't lose. Guess I'm on my way. Need any friend? And I feel now, I guess I'll be with you till the end.
At Raising Cane's, we don't have employees, we have a crew.
My crew's got my back.
We work hard.
And have fun!
Because when you're part of a crew,
it's just what you do.
Raising Cane's Chicken Fingers. One crew, one love.
Okay, this is a freezer, not a time capsule. Sometimes the house itself can tell you how a young homeowner is turning into their parents.
Not those two.
Yep, they're gone.
Forever?
Yep.
That there is Progressive's Home Quote Explorer website where I compared home insurance rates.
We don't need to print the internet. Some are beyond help. I will give you $100 if you can tell me what this is.
Scotch egg.
Meatball.
Progressive can't help you from becoming your parents, but we can help you compare rates on home insurance with Home Quote Explorer.
We've got a lot of work to do.
Two runs, five hits, one error for LSU. No runs, no hits, and one error for Nicholls. And the Colonels have gone to their bullpen for the first time. It's Bradley Ely out of Frisco, Texas, up in the Dallas area. Ely is the first reliever for Nicholls.
You see his numbers, 10 and a third innings so far this year. High ERA, got 12 hits and 10 and a third innings pitched. And tell you a little bit about Ely, 6'1", 180-pound junior. Came to Thibodaux by way of Galveston College. Some more on Ely. This is his 10th appearance on the year. Opponents are batting 293 against them this season.
LSU shortstop Jordan Thompson is the first hitter against Ely. Joubert and McManus will follow. Thompson lines one into the right center field gap, and it is over the head of LeBlanc, the center fielder. Thompson will stop at second base with a ringing double to open the bottom of the third inning, and that is a dozen doubles now for the LSU infielder.
Well, that's going to feel good for Thompson, who made the error in the field, able to kind of make up for a little bit right here. This ball just hammered out to the right center field gap. Thompson in there easily. 12 doubles on the year, third most on the team for Jordan Thompson.
Hit number six for the Tigers, the second double. McManus, who's on deck, had the first one. And here is Joubert, who flied to center field last time. Steve Reichen, a nice delivery under the hands on the inside corner. Thompson with that double has now hit safely in four consecutive games.
Another interesting stat about Jordan Thompson. He has more walks than strikeouts this year. And for a guy who's had a lot of at-bats, that's pretty impressive. 26 walks, only 25 strikeouts for Jordan Thompson. So he's another high on-base percentage guy. On-base percentage up around 390 after that base hit.
Well, the 739 headed south is right on time. There it is. The first one was going the other way. The outfield is very deep and straight away. Joubert hits a routine ground ball to the right side. Felix will take the out at first base, but it moves Thompson to third with one gone.
Joe Baer trying to pull something on the right side that time, you know, with a runner at second and no outs, did his job. Now it's up to McManus, who is a fly ball type hitter, to get him in.
More than half of exactly half of McManus's 20 hits have been for extra bases. He's had three doubles, three triples, and four homers. So that's 10 extra base hits among his 20 hits this year. McManus this season is 3-for-7 in scoring a runner from third base with less than two outs. Let's see if he can make that 4-for-8. Ely got it in on the hands of McManus. That's firewood with a wooden bat.
Yeah, he was able to get in there pretty good. Only takes one for McManus.
McManus hammered a double off the left field wall last time and scored on an RBI single by Pearson. Two nothing Tigers on six base hits. Both runs came last inning. Tyler's batting average has ascended to 260. The infield is pursed toward the plate. The 3-2 pitch. High and tight. And the Tigers have runners on the corners. This does set up an opportunity for a double play. Josh Stevenson runs well, though, from the left side. He walked and scored last time on an RBI single by Jacob Berry.
Now Josh Stevenson runs really well, so if he gets the ball on the ground and got the opportunity to beat it out for, you know, a double play.
Stevenson batted against the left-hander in his first at bat. He's 0-for-8 this year against left-handed pitching, but he's 290 against pitchers from the starboard side.
He has hit into one double play this year.
The infield has retreated into double play depth. Thompson at third after a solid double to left field. He moved up on an infield out. McManus has walked. The 0-1 pitch. Hit sharply up the middle. It's under the glove of the second baseman Felix. A run scores and runners finish on the corners. Stevenson hit it sharply. It looked like Felix might have a chance to make a backhanded play, but the ball got beyond him.
As ball hit sharply, I thought Felix might knock it down and then he could flip it to short and make it interesting at first, but didn't come up with it. And a nice base hit by Josh Stevenson. He hit it sharply and was rewarded. Former St. Thomas More star, who, by the way, his alma mater is going to be in Baton Rouge this week, taking on Parkview Baptist in a 2-out-of-3 series in the playoffs on Thursday, Friday, and Saturday.
That will be a dandy.
A lot of state championships between those two schools over the last 30 years.
Here's Josh Pearson. He's 1-for-2. He has struck out and driven in a run with a base hit. McManus is at third. This ball is tagged. Back it goes. Back it goes. You can pucker up and kiss that baby goodbye. Josh Pearson, who's been swinging a terrific pipe the last few weeks, homers for the fifth time this year.
Boy, Josh Pearson, how about the two freshmen? Back-to-back freshmen, single, homer, and that equates to big inning for the LSU Tigers. Remember, Pearson had that single on the 0-2 breaking ball last time up in the zone. He goes high heat again and runs that one out of the yard. Back-to-back hits by Pearson on pitches that weren't strikes.
So the Tigers erupt for four. Three of them on the home run by Pearson. And here's Cruz, who's 2-for-2. Strike one to the LSU center fielder. Bradley Ely has been touched for a double, a walk, an RBI single, and a three-run home run.
Now, Josh Pearson now with five home runs in the last 23 days. So he is heated up.
How about 20 RBI now? Four of them in this game. Cruz hits it sharply down to Cadu. And there's the out at first base. So Cruz is retired for the first time. And here is Jacob Berry, whose RBI single in the second inning moved his hitting streak to four games.
It was well played that time by Cadu. That ball was hit sharply, but he came through the baseball, took his momentum through, got rid of it quickly, came and got the good hop. That's what you got to do as a middle infielder. Come get the baseball.
Berry out of Queen Creek, Arizona. One for two tonight.
Uh-oh.
This is hit high. It's hit deep. Everybody's just turning and looking way out of here. You can pucker up and kiss that baby goodbye. Adios. Jacob Berry, for the 15th time this season, hits one out of sight.
He ran that one up on the roof out there in right field, over the bleachers, onto that roof where the LSU weight room is for the baseball team. Another pitch elevated. He knew he got it. A mega bat flip. Watch over the right side. You see it kicks off of the top of the bleachers and it kicks to the right onto the roof. And that was a bullet, too. That wasn't a towering shot. That ball was a line drive out of the yard.
Jacob Berry is going to be billed for broken tile at the end of the year.
No, I don't think they're going to send him the bill. I think they'll eat it. If he wants to keep hitting home runs onto the roof out in right field, LSU will gladly pay for the tile.
Here's Cade Doty, who's hit safely in four straight games.
By the way, those tile that we just showed are very expensive. They're big and expensive. I don't have that on my roof. I've got the old school shingles.
There's a couple of crunch marks out there. Cadu charges and flips it over for the out. But a huge inning for LSU. A double by Thompson. A base hit by Stevenson, which produced a run. Pearson hits a home run, and so does Berry. We move forward. It's 7-0 now after 5 in the third for the LSU Tigers.
T-Mobile home internet yet? Trim your hedge.
It's $50 a month with no price hikes. Bam!
Sir!
It runs on T-Mobile's wireless 5G network, so all you gotta do is plug in one cord.
T-Mobile 5G home internet. Just $50 a month. No price hikes, no hidden fees.
I did it.
Ah!
I switched to T-Mobile home internet, and I am loving it.
Don't sneak up on me like that!
Why didn't you tell me to switch earlier?
At Hampton by Hilton, contactless arrival means she can skip the front desk, go straight to her room, unlock her door, and head right to bed. Book our family of brands at Hilton.com. To new memories, Hilton.
Come in for workout gear. Leave feeling empowered. Come in for snack time. Leave more fulfilled. Because when you shop at Target, you leave with what you value most. Like healthy foods shouldn't cost more. Value most shouldn't cost more. Value most shouldn't cost more.
As a struggling actor, I need all the breaks that I can get. At Liberty Buchanan.
Cut.
Liberty Bibbity.
Cut.
Liberty Mutual customizes your car insurance. Mutual customizes your car insurance. So you only pay for what you... Line?
Need.
Action.
Cut. You can't say that.
Sorry. Is this where they're gonna put the Statue of Liberty? Liberty... Are we married to Mutual?
Cut.
Only pay for what you need.
Liberty, 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 Liberty.
For LSU, no runs, no hits, one error. For Nicholls. For LSU, no runs, no hits, one error. For Nicholls. Everything in the Southland Conference is jammed up near the top. Look at Nicholls and McNeese and Houston Baptist, all at 11-7. New Orleans and Northwestern State and Southeastern Louisiana are 9-9. Texas A&M, Corpus Christi, and Incarnate Word out of San Antonio are 6-12. Remember, the first place team at the end of the year during the regular season will host a four-team, quote, regional. The second place team will host a four-team, quote, regional. The two teams that emerge from that will play two out of three the next weekend at the highest seeds home park, and that will determine the Southland Conference champion. Here's Paz, who takes strike two.
That's pretty fun for the fans, you know, to do it that way. I mean, imagine if the Southeastern Conference had some, you know, pod tournaments like
that,
for the tournament. That would be really neat. But
well, it certainly rewards regular season play.
So in a big way. It rewards you at the box office, you know, at the gate as well as on the field. So at the moment, the Colonels would be one of those teams hosting.
Well, depending, because there's three at the top right now, but they'll sort it all out with tiebreakers, etc. Paz and Felix and LeBlanc against Hasty here in the fourth. Hasty came on to strike out Alvarez with runners at first and third in the third inning.
At the moment, the two teams that the Colonels are tied with, Houston Baptist and McNeese, they lost two out of three to the Colonels to McNeese, and they lost two out of three to Houston Baptist.
So right now those other teams have the tiebreakers against the Colonels, right?
Yep.
The 1-2 pitch to Paz from Hasty. Grounded to the backhand side. Thompson comes up firing. Yes! What a play!
There you go. Didn't have time to think about it, Lynn. You know, had to just react. Nice backhanded play. And then just fired across the diamond. Right here, quickly. Plant the feet, turn and throw. And he's got a big time arm. And that time he didn't think about it. He extended and he threw a strike to first.
A terrific play by the freshly shorn Jordan Thompson.
Yeah, Thompson, who cut his hair prior to the weekend, and you almost don't recognize him out there.
Here's Garrett Felix. He's from Lafayette. He was hit by a pitch and was left at second base in the second inning. Hasty finds the inside part of the plate.
Colonel's last two Southland Conference weekend series at Texas A&M Corpus Christi this week, then at home against their big rival, the Southeastern Lions, before finishing the year at in Cajun territory with the Raging Cajuns, who've been red hot.
up for Jacob Hasty. He has retired four in a row coming out of the bullpen. 7-0 Tigers.
Is dented.
Geico does offer 24/7 claim service.
24/7? That's a lot of attention.
They're not actually with you 24/7. They're just available whenever you need them.
Okay, because I'm an introvert. It's incredibly rare.
I don't think that's...
Oh, no, they didn't. Papa John's just took all that pepperoni and hand-stuffed it inside that garlic-kissed crust. And this here ain't just any pepperoni. Oh, no, no. That's Papa John's pepperoni. That signature recipe right there delivers a kick of blended spices. Pow! Right to the kisser. Now that's an epic pepperoni-stuffed crust pizza like no mouth has ever seen. Better ingredients, better pizza, even better when it's stuffed.
Bonded. I could use an Avenger.
This is going to be fun.
This Friday, the madness begins.
I don't even want to know!
Marvel's Doctor Strange, rated PG-13.
LSU with two in the second and a five-run explosion in the third. And the Tigers lead comfortably as Luke Barbier comes out of the Nicholls bullpen. This is the second reliever. He replaces Bradley Ely, who did not fare well in the third inning.
Luke, a lefty out of Morgan City. Second year, he prepped at Central Catholic High School in Morgan City. Only his sixth appearance of the year. He's only logged four in a third inning so far. Opponents are batting only 235 against Barbier, but he has walk five.
Morgan turns away from that high inside pitch. Mancuso went two innings. He got through the first, although the Tigers left the bases loaded. He surrendered five hits on a couple of runs in two innings of work, a walk and a couple of strikeouts. Bradley Ely pitched the third and was touched for a double and a couple of home runs. And a single. He walked a batter. He gave up five runs on four hits. And now it's Luke Barbier. Two and one on Morgan. He has reached on an error and a fielder's choice. He's 0 for 2. Morgan draws a base on balls.
And Barbier did not throw a strike that entire at-bat. Even the one that Morgan swung at was out of the strike zone. And that's kind of been what we've seen from him this year. Five walks and four and a third. He's also hit a couple of batters and has two wild pitches.
LSU is going to extract Morgan from the game. Luke Leto is the pinch runner. Leto running for Morgan. So obviously in a 7-0 game, Morgan has lifted mid-game to try to rest that twisted knee. Here's Jordan Thompson, who has bounced out to third and smacked a double into left field last time and scored. He got the five-run third started, did Jordan Thompson, who now has hit safely in four straight games. One ball, one strike to the LSU shortstop. Braden Joubert is on deck.
That pitch was called a strike, and it was closer to Thompson than to the plate. Watch this ball. I mean, it almost hits Thompson on the belt. It was called a strike. That's,
you know, you would have been a first-round draft pick with a strike zone like this.
I'd still be pitching. Luke Lito over there at first base, big-time prospect out of Michigan. Only a freshman. Got a start last week. Only start of the year at first base. You know, again, with Morgan with that banged up knee, they let Morgan DH against UNO down in New Orleans and let Lito get a start in that ball game. He went 0 for 3, but did have an RBI.
There have not been a lot of LSU players on the roster from Michigan. Lito has a fairly good lead. Not going anywhere. Thompson swings and can't find it. And there's the first out of the inning. Mancuso struck out two. It's the first for Barbier. Here's Braden Joubert, the designated hitter. Joubert has flied to center and bounced out to the second baseman.
Of all the players from Michigan that have played at LSU, as you mentioned, not many. Two of the best. You got a name?
I don't.
Now, DJ LeMahieu, pretty great player, was on that 09 national championship team, and he's been a fantastic pro. And then a teammate of mine who's one of the all-time great hitters, Harry Berrios, who was a member of the 91 and 93 national championship teams. And Harry, for at one point when he finished his pro career, he never made the majors, got to AAA, played a lot of professional baseball. He was second all-time in hits in minor league baseball when you count the minors and independent pro baseball all together. Baseball America did an article on him years ago. At the time when he retired, he had the second most hits of any professional baseball player in the minors.
I think Harry's still playing, actually.
He's not. Coach Burtman used to call him Horse. He was a great running back in high school, and he had a big bottom half, big thick legs. Looked like Dalton Hilliard out there in a uniform.
And a four-pitch pass. He played hurt, too. So a walk to Morgan. A strikeout and a walk to 3-0. Joubert on the minimum number. And a four-pitch pass. So a walk to Morgan. A strikeout and a walk to Joubert on the minimum number of pitches. Lito is the runner at second base. Joubert at first. And we will have a conversation. There's a couple of relievers up and throwing. Bergeron is the left-hander and Gailey is the right-hander. And we'll take a pitching change timeout right here as Barbier faced three batters. He struck out the middle one and walked the first and third. And with LSU leading 7-0 in the fourth, Nicholls will make another pitching change.
People need to read it.
I can't read it.
It's because you're like four.
Four and a half.
Switch to Progressive and you can save hundreds. You know, like the sign says.
We're Malika Mouse.
We're scientists.
We're engineers.
We dance, but not so well. We get really excited about science, and we want to share that excitement with the world.
Windows 11 makes things easier.
One of the biggest features I use is multiple desktops. By just swiping the screen, I go from being a student to being a gamer.
The biggest dreams we have.
And Windows 11 helps us do it.
One of the biggest dreams we have.
And Windows 11 helps us do it.
Gavin Galley is the third reliever for Nicholls. He's a sophomore out of Orlando, Florida.
Galley hasn't had tremendous numbers this year, only 5 1/3 innings, 11 hits, but kind of gives you almost like a side slinger, sidearm approach, although it's more of like he crunches down and throws it a little bit three-quarter. But a little different approach and different look he gives you. Out of Orlando, Florida, only a sophomore, business major, 6'2", 175-pounder.
Tyler McManus will face yet another pitcher. He's had an at-bat against the starter, Mancuso, and his second at-bat came against Ely, and now his third at-bat is against Galley.
You know, they're playing Call in Baton Rouge here at Alex Box Stadium. They just finished the song. Quite different than it was on Saturday night in Tiger Stadium when in front of 102,000 people, I was there, Lynn. It was an amazing atmosphere. Garth Brooks sang Call in Baton Rouge, and for the first time since 1988, the Richter scale shook again, and there was an earthquake in Tiger Stadium, and it registered on the Richter scale across campus while Colin Baton Rouge was playing. So Eddie Fuller is not the only one that can make the Richter scale wake up. Garth Brooks did it too Saturday night.
Well, when I drove up to the ballpark, I saw those still a few people trying to extract themselves from ditches and under trees and who knows what else, but apparently it was quite the happening.
It was big time. When's the last time you went to a concert? Do you remember when that was or what you went to?
Well, actually, I've been to a few that might surprise you. Blood, Sweat, and Tears.
Mm-hmm.
But within recent years.
Okay,
great yeah. Concert.
Now, like at a casino.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Joe Cocker, which was one of the best concerts I've ever seen.
I would have liked to have seen him back in the day.
I've been to Nashville a few times, and although I am not a country music aficionado, I appreciate it, and some songs I really like, but I've been to Grand Ole Opry 3 or 4 times. It's something special. You don't have to be a country music fan to enjoy Grand Ole Opry. And the format there is, you know, maybe 18 or 20 acts, and nobody sings more than 3 songs.
Right.
Some superstars come out and do one number, and they're gone. But nobody does more than 3.
I've never done the Grand Ole Opry.
You
That's
need to
on
go.
The bucket list.
You would love it. Let's see if McManus can get a pitch he loves.
He did last time, though.
He sure did. Well, actually.
No, it's Pearson. My bad.
McManus had a double in
Ooh.
The second. Hits
My
this
goodness.
One sharply, throw back to second base for the double play. McManus lines to Cadu, who got it to Felix, a 6-4 twin killing. And the inning is over on this smash by McManus.
Alito didn't do anything wrong, just the ball was hit right at the shortstop. Barreled it up with the Tigers there in total control. 7-0, they lead the Colonels.
For adventure, your home. For romance, your home. For big savings.
Hey, Mom, have you seen my... Ew.
Because when you bundle home and auto with Progressive, your home is a savings paradise. Bundles Progressive, your home for savings.
Gillette introduces the all-new Gillette Labs with exfoliating bar, a razor designed to give you a quick and easy shave. It combines shaving and gentle exfoliation into one efficient stroke. The bar in the handle removes unseen dirt and debris that gets in the way of the blades, giving you a shave as quick and easy as washing your face, so you can look like you put in an effort, effortlessly. Gillette, the best a man can get.
After another tremendous performance out of the bullpen by Jacob Hasty, Ty Floyd will come out and pitch the fifth inning and perhaps beyond. Ty Floyd has seven decisions. He's 4-3 on the year.
Well, see if Floyd can keep it going. The Tigers have had a nice little rhythm to start the game. You see Floyd, a lot of strikeouts, strong arm, going to run it up there, 92-95. The walks have, popped up a little bit the last few times out, and they've tried a lot more breaking balls. You know, not long ago, Floyd threw seven or eight breaking balls in a row, one of his last appearances.
This is the way the game has gone. The Tigers got two in the second, five in the third to really take control. Collins and Hasty have been super good so far for LSU on the mound. Pearson 2-for-3 with a home run. And, of course, another home run by Jacob Berry as well, as he literally hit it out of the ballpark for his 15th dinger of the season. And LSU is in control on nine base hits. Ty Floyd to the plate. Swing and a miss on Heat. Lito is in the game at first base, so Luke Lito, who became a pinch runner for Morgan, remains in the game at first base.
Been a little mixed bag for Ty Floyd the last two times out, Lynn. You know, 2 weeks ago against the Raging Cajuns in the last final Wally Ponoff Junior Classic, as we take a look at Lito at first, Floyd got the start. He went five innings, gave up four hits, two earned runs, struck out eight, didn't walk anybody. One of his best outings of the year. So, all right, got some momentum going. But then last week down in the Big Easy at the lakefront, only an inning and a third, gave up four earned runs, walked a couple of batters, didn't strike out anybody, and then now back to the bullpen for Floyd.
There's no question that Floyd can do that time after time. That was a 95-mile-an-hour beautifully delivered pitch.
I mean, that ball is just spot Steve perfect. Watch, down and low, low and away. 95. Perfect spot.
But is there a secondary pitch that Floyd can use effectively? That's the huge question that remains to be answered. And that's been the question since last fall.
Yeah, you know, it's the off-speed pitch that he has is kind of an old-school pop-up curve. And from his arm slot, where he sort of short-arms the ball just a touch, kind of comes right out of the armpit, you would think the cutter slider would be the better option.
Cruz has Trahan played perfectly as he drifts a few steps to his left to take the liner for the second out. There have been only three base runners for Nicholls. Felix was hit by a pitch with one out in the second inning. Cadu walked with one out in the third. And Washington reached on an error in that inning. Those have been the only three Nicholls base runners. Two outs, Cadu at the plate. He had a three-game hitting streak coming into the game. We play in the fifth. Nice play there by,
well done,
Ty Floyd. Lito got to the bag perfectly, and another 1-2-3 inning.
Only nine pitches for Floyd, and of course, pitchers are always the best athletes, Lynn.
Uh-huh. 7-0 LSU leading on nine base hits.
coolest things.
People need to read it.
I can't read it.
It's because you're like four.
Four and a half.
Switch to Progressive and you can save hundreds. You know, like the sign says.
At Hilton, check in, choose your room, and unlock your door. All in the Hilton app, thus preserving the rarest of species, the sleeping toddler. Book our family of brands at Hilton.com. To new memories, Hilton.
7-0 Tigers, 2 in the second, 5 in the third. And Evan Keith is the new pitcher for the Nicholls Colonels. Keith follows Galley, who followed Barbier, who followed Ely, who followed the starter Mancuso.
Say that all back real fast. Here's Keith's numbers. They kind of look like the guy before him. Very similar. A lot of different arms. You mentioned the Galley who pitched last inning, Gavin Galley, number 17. Wanted to work this in while we have the chance. His dad, Al, actually caught, was a member of the 1986 team at LSU. And of course, his uncle is Andy Galley, who played at Jesuit and was a heck of a player for the LSU Tigers at second base in the mid-late 80s. Andy's son actually played for the Colonels, so all kind of connections to the Colonels and LSU Tigers is the Galley clan.
There's also a new third baseman. This is Kyle Boudreaux as he replaces Austin Kane. Josh Stevenson has walked, has reached on an infield hit. He has scored twice. And Keith starts him with a strike.
Evan Keith with the little wayback machine. Sort of a poor man's Dennis Eckersley with that relief, with that.
LSU looking for its 30th victory of the season. Tigers are 3 above 500 in the SEC. Nicholls is 4 ahead of 500 in the Southland Conference. LSU has had good production from hitters 8 and 9 tonight. McManus and Stevenson have been on base 4 times. That's a good off-speed pitch. Really good, and Stevenson was not expecting it. Bat went one way, the backside went the other, and there wasn't much chance.
Pulled the string in a big way. Watch this changeup. Starts on the plate, breaks off the plate. Excellent movement, arm side. From Evan Keith.
LSU has struck out 4 times tonight. Pearson hits one high. He hits it deep to center field. Is back. And it is out of here. You can pucker up and kiss that baby goodbye. Six home runs for Josh Pearson.
And that one was
2 tonight.
Dead center off the glad bag in center field. Watch right here, just steady Eddie, minimal movement, short compact, and that ball hits halfway up the garbage bag for a homer. Now 6 home runs in his last 23 days.
So Pearson, following a strikeout in the first, has an RBI single, a 3-run home run, and a 1-run home run. Cruz is thrown out by the shortstop after Pearson lights the scoreboard again.
I think every at-bat for Pearson's, for Cruz has looked the same, huh? Like those hard ground balls on the left side.
Pearson with 5 runs driven in tonight. That matches his season's high. He had 5 against Mississippi State.
Yeah, he was named the SEC Freshman of the Week that weekend in the series. as LSU went up to Starkville and took care of the Bulldogs.
Jacob Berry homered last time. He also has an RBI single. He's 2 for 3.
The thing about Pearson that impressed me is his temperament, Lynn. He doesn't look nervous. He's, you know, steady. Here's the Jacob Berry who... ends up off the back of the stands, ends up on the roof, and the Drew Brees lookalike celebrates with his teammates after his 15th bomb of the year.
Berry takes a strike.
Fourteen of Berry's 15 homers have come from while he's hit left-handed.
Ooh. That one is off the pitcher's leg, and it's rerouted to right field. A sizzler right back off of Evan Keith. That'll be purple tomorrow. Jacob Berry has his third hit.
Boy, he's seeing the ball well right now. Beach ball, that ball right off the ankle. Ouch. Sometimes as a hitter, you can get unlucky, and that ball can bounce right to the defense. That time it did not.
So Pearson at the top of the order has homered twice and singled. Cruz has a couple of base hits. Berry with three. That's eight base hits for LSU's first three hitters. Doty backs away from a strike. He's 0 for 2 and looking to extend his hitting streak, which right now is at 4. Evan Keith with a runner at first unleashes a big breaking ball. Leto is on deck. Two outs, a run in on a straightaway home run by Josh Pearson. A called third strike, a nice breaking pitch. Fools Doty, and the inning is over. A couple of strikeouts for Evan Keith in the frame. But Josh Pearson unloads. This ball winds up over the center field wall, and the Tigers on that blow add to their lead. 8-0 LSU over Nicholls.
PTI, I need the PDFCOBAKAEOD. What's the ETA?
ASAP, FYI.
CMIIM?
TLDR.
What?
Too long, didn't read.
We don't need any more acronyms, but we could all use more ways to save.
PNX, YOLO!
Come in for workout gear. Leave feeling empowered. Come in for snack time. Leave more fulfilled. Because when you shop at Target, you leave with what you value most. Like healthy foods shouldn't cost more. Value most shouldn't cost more. Within reach. What we value most shouldn't cost more.
My garden brings us together. My garden brings us together.
My garden is my therapy.
Find more ways to grow at MiracleGrow.com.
Put some spring in your sip with cold brew topped with cold foam at Dunkin'. A little salty with our salted caramel cold foam, or a little sweet with our sweet cold foam. Either way, it'll be smooth sipping from here on out. Spring on the cold brew. America runs on Dunkin'.
Introducing the all-electric Chevy Silverado RST. The only EV truck that combines four-wheel steer, a multi-flex midgate, and up to a 400-mile range on a full charge. And the only way to reserve it is at Chevy.com. Find your future. Find new roads.
Three scoring frames tonight have produced eight runs for LSU. Nicholls comes to the plate in the sixth. This is what LSU has done against SEC competition this year. They lost a series to Texas A&M. They beat Florida, lost to Auburn, swept Mississippi State, got swept by Arkansas, got the series win against Missouri in a sweep, and then a 2-1 advantage in games against Georgia last weekend. Remaining games for LSU in the league: Alabama, Ole Miss, and Vanderbilt.
That Vanderbilt matchup is going to be interesting for LSU. I know Vanderbilt isn't as scary as they've been in the last few years, but they've got a lot of team speed, and that's going to be a challenge for LSU in that last weekend in Nashville. If you're a Tiger fan, you hope they take care of business the next two weekends to where there's not as much pressure on that final series to go have to sweep or something like that on the road.
When is the last time Vanderbilt was not ranked at this point in the season?
Been a minute, that's for sure.
Vanderbilt was beaten tonight by number 10 Louisville, 1-0 the final. Jordan Thompson cuts loose with a strong throw for the out. Well, Simon grounds out to LSU's shortstop. Tennessee walloped Alabama A&M 14-1. Florida a big winner tonight over South Florida. That's a final. It's 18-3. So Vanderbilt losing 1-0 to Louisville. Florida beating South Florida 18-3. And Tennessee scoring 14 times and yielding one against Alabama A&M. Those are the three finals we have so far. Zane Washington out of Houma swings and is tardy. Bryce Collins went 2 2/3. Jacob Hasty pitched an inning and a third and struck out three of the four batters he faced. Ty Floyd is in his second inning of work. LSU pitchers have struck out six. They've walked one and hit a batter. Washington is late, and he'll stroll back to the dugout.
Boy, it's just so effortless for Ty Floyd. I mean, 93 miles an hour, comes out of the hand nice and easy. Nothing to it, just hits a spot.
Collins struck out two, Hasty three, and now Floyd two. This brings on Alvarez, who's 0-2 with a strikeout. He was the first batter that Hasty faced in the third inning with runners on the corners and two outs.
That's when you know you're in a tough spot right there. When Floyd flips a first pitch slow curve in there, all of a sudden as a hitter, you're like, is he really going to throw me a bunch of curveballs? And then, boom, he sizzles you with a 94-mile-an-hour heater, and all you can do is foul it off.
That's hit up the middle, and it will find center field. Alvarez, the best hitter for Nicholls, collects the first base hit of the game for the Colonels, and it comes in the sixth. A two-out bouncer right back through the middle.
Yeah, that was, you could tell he's a good quality hitter because that ball was a little off the plate. They should have, Floyd was trying to miss by a little more than what he did. And Alvarez, after seeing the fastball previously and just missed it, wasn't going to miss it again.
So Nicholls collects its first base hit in the sixth inning. And we've got a pinch hitter. This is Cody O'Connor, a sophomore, batting for Alec Paz, who fouled out and grounded out. O'Connor O'Connor out of Lebanon, Ohio, hitting 148. Alvarez with a moderate lead. That's an off-speed pitch. You don't see much of those from Ty Floyd.
Yeah, that's a wrinkle. 78 mile an hour straight change. He's got a little feel for it.
That's two in a row. He missed with the first one.
Yeah. I like that they're experimenting here and working in other pitches into his repertoire. We know he's got the good solid 92-95 heater. And that makes that fastball look even faster after two straight changeups.
He goes back to it. And O'Connor is.
That's three outs, guys.
Down on strikes. A little hesitation before the Tigers came off the field. But Nicholls finally breaks into the hit column but remains shut out. LSU out in front, 8-0 over Nicholls as we go to the bottom of the sixth.
Applebee's Irresistibles are back, now starting at $8.99. Now that's eating good in the...
Why don't you do cool spins?
People need to read it.
I can't read it.
It's because you're like four.
Half.
Switch to Progressive and you can save hundreds. You know, like the sign says.
I love Bowie, but boot camp? Sounds intense.
Let's go, Peloton!
It's not that big a lift.
What's that for?
Just go with the flow.
Feel the energy.
I couldn't even do one of these.
Full breath in.
Now look at me.
3, 2, 1, let's go to the top.
Let's sleep well tonight.
LSU carries an 8-0 lead into the bottom of the sixth inning. And reliever number 5 is on the mound for Nicholls. This is Dylan Bergeron, a freshman out of Houma. The left-hander will face Leto and Thompson and Joubert. Bergeron with no record. And only an inning and two-thirds to his credit. He's allowed one hit, struck out 3, walked 3. This is appearance number 4, so he's basically been a one-batter or one-out guy in his previous very brief appearances.
Yeah, the big fella, 6-foot, 220-pound freshman out of Edie White High School down in Houma. Good matchup right here is Luke Leto getting an opportunity to work off of a left-hander.
We've got a second Jordan Thompson in the game right now. And this is Nicholls' Jordan Thompson. He's the new second baseman. Leto is hit by a pitch. He turned away from it, but it clipped him.
Well, that's not what you want when you're a guy who only has 8 official at-bats this year. You want to be able to swing it a little bit. Instead, a little high heat right off the back. That'll leave a mark. Right here, Leto, 0-1, leaning in, and then he just takes it right off the shoulder.
Collier Cranford is going to bat for Jordan Thompson and undoubtedly stay in the game at shortstop. So just as soon as we get two Jordan Thompsons in the game, LSU's Jordan Thompson is lifted for the pinch hitter Cranford.
Well, they exceeded the quota. That's what happened. They had to get him out of there.
Thompson was 1-for-3. He had a wall-banging double, or rather, actually a double into the gap. Back in the second inning, he was and also struck out and bounced out. He committed an error, but he also made a couple of very fine plays from deep shortstop. Well, Cranford batting and will very likely stay in the game on the infield.
Cranford out of Zachary High School, suburb of Baton Rouge.
Bergeron with a long stretch, uncorks it. One ball, two strikes.
Looked like Cranford might have got the Nicholls catcher with the foul through on the bat accidentally. Watch right here when the bat comes around and then, oops, right on the head.
The 2-2 pitch.
Also for Nicholls, there's a new second baseman. Now at second base, number one, Jordan Thompson. Thompson is at second base for the Cardinals.
Nobody out, a runner at first base. It's Lito after being clipped by a pitch. And that one dives inside. It's 3-2.
Kyle Cranford, who known for his defense in his time at LSU.
Runner is on the move. Ground ball at the shortstop. There will be no play at second, but there is a play at first. Well, by putting Lito in motion, the first option for Cadu was taken away, and the Nicholls shortstop gunned it over to get Cranford.
Hit sharply, but well done by LSU starting at the motion, as you mentioned, because that was a tailor-made double play if Lito isn't on the go.
Jim, Ronnie, we've been notified that Hall of Fame broadcaster, one of the iconic voices in the history of LSU and across the country, Jim Hawthorne, is very ill. He's been hospitalized. He could certainly use our concern, our prayers, and the best to his lovely and longtime wife, Carol Hawthorne, as well. So all the best to Jim Hawthorne tonight and in the future.
That's terrible to hear. Let's hope Jim feels and hears and feels those prayers and can pull through. I know you guys go way, way, way back to working together in college at Northwestern State.
We do. Spent a lot of miles together. Remember, Jim, these are the primitive days of radio and baseball broadcasting. Certainly not nearly as common as it is now, but I can remember Jim jury-rigging apparatus to get us on the air, actually hooking up cables to his car battery.
Wow. Well, when we first met, I was in high school playing football at Menard High, and I remember you sitting on top of a van doing a game on TV on the Axe Network in Alexandria back in the 80s.
For those not familiar with the Axe Network, American Christian Television Service, that a local church put together and provided a lot of volunteer labor, guys who worked hard and wanted to try to see what they could do in television. A lot of local programming.
How long was that around at Alexandria?
I think 3 or 4 years in the sports part of it. It used to do an occasional game or two in the summer with the Alexandria Aces baseball team, the minor league club. 3-1 on Joubert. And he draws a base on balls from Dylan Bergeron.
Second time tonight Joubert has walked. You know, he's anxious to try to get a hit or a double or a home or something against his old team. But he's been patient at the plate, walked a couple times. And we're probably going to have a new pitcher.
It appears that Brandon Andrews will be next for Nicholls. So Nicholls summons yet another reliever. LSU has an 8-0 lead, and we will return to Baton Rouge after this timeout on the SEC ESPN Network.
Lucky for me, there's some great golf here in the Carolinas. Whether you golf or not, GEICO could help you score some great savings on car insurance.
Whoa!
Oh, all in one.
GEICO. See all the ways you could save.
In the future, we'll travel to incredible places with the help of magical technology.
But what about today?
I can't wait for what tomorrow will bring. But in the meantime, let's enjoy the ride.
Put some spring in your sip with cold brew topped with cold foam at Dunkin'. A little salty with our smooth sipping from here on out. Spring on the cold brew. America runs on Dunkin'. Smooth sipping from here on out. Spring on the cold brew. America runs on Dunkin'.
To introduce our new Kingsford charcoal. Made with real spices. We asked TikTok's angry reactions for his expert opinion.
Cold foam or a little sweet with our sweet cold foam. Either way, it'll be smooth sipping from here on out. Spring on the cold brew. America runs on Dunkin'.
Thanks, man.
It's flavor like never before.
This senior out of North Carolina, Brandon Andrews, is the new pitcher for Nicholls. This is pitcher number 7, the 6th reliever, obviously. And Brandon Andrews comes in with LSU leading 8-0. 2-1 record, good ERA, 1.84. Only 14 and two-thirds innings. 11 hits allowed. He has struck out 15, and he's walked only 5. So this is a cut above, at least statistically, from what we've seen from previous Nicholls relievers tonight.
Yeah, he's one of their better relievers. He's a guy who was a transfer from Jacksonville State. That's where he pitched last year. He only saw action in one game. He was out the entire 2020 season due to an injury. Took a red shirt that year. But back in 2019, he made 24 appearances for the Colonels. And in 2018, he made 13 appearances. So a guy who, I'm sorry, only made one appearance last year at Jacksonville State. He's been at Nicholls for 5 years, redshirted one due to injury. And this year, it's kind of come together for him nicely with that tidy 1.5 earned run average.
He starts McManus with a breaking ball for a strike. Tyler has doubled off the wall and scored. He has walked and scored. He lined into a 6-4 double play.
Is what the scout report was on him, and he had a great fall, got injured, but now with him having to play more, he's starting to get healthy, and it's coming together offensively. The average continuing to just go up and up.
Stevenson takes ball one from Andrews. LSU with a dozen base hits through 6 innings. The Tigers have not been retired in order tonight. Stevenson has walked, singled in a run, scored twice, and struck out.
I'm determined to get this right on Brandon Andrews, okay. The new reliever for the Cardinals.
Okay.
He started his career at Nicholls, pitched 2 years. Redshirted the third year due to an injury. Transferred to Jacksonville State. Pitched that, one game.
That would have been his fourth year.
And then came back to Nicholls this season.
Okay.
And has had a very good year.
Okay. So 5 years overall, one in which he didn't pitch. And this is his second stint at Nicholls.
Normally you don't see a player have two stints at the same school. Not very common.
No, but the draw of crawfish and cracklins and boudin and jambalaya.
And maybe
and,
a girl.
And gumbo, possibly. Three balls and a strike to Josh Stevenson. That one gets by the catcher, but that was ball four.
So the second time tonight, Stevenson walks, right?
Yes, it is.
So that's walk number 11 on the year. And that on-base percentage continues to hover in the right around 400 for Josh Stevenson.
Here's right fielder Josh Pearson. He's had a tremendous night. After striking out in the first, he has singled in a run. He has a three-run home run and a solo home run. Round trippers number 5 and 6. Five RBI tonight for Pearson for the second time in his career. The first time was against Mississippi State, and in that game, he had two home runs.
But Pearson loves the high ball. That ball was up at the letters. And he takes that one to dead center. Just so balanced and poised for a freshman hitter. Reminds me with that pop for a guy who's not a big guy of a Mike Fontenot.
I was going to say Mike Fontenot. Mm-hmm.
Even the swing, somewhat similar. That uppercut, which it's always going to be an uppercut when you when you're sub 6 foot tall.
Pearson waves at that one, and it was much out of the strike zone. Josh Pearson is a compact 195 pounds on a 5'10 frame.
You know, sometimes when you look back at LSU's last national championship in 2009, Paul Maneri that year really started playing some of those super freshmen later in the year, the Hanovers, the Nolas, the Matuks. They sort of emerged into April and into May. And it looks like to me, obviously the injury to Dugas had a little something to do with it, but you know, Pearson not having to be a guy right away allowed him to ease into the season, bide his time, get some opportunities, be patient, and then when they did kind of give him the reins full time, he has made the most of it.
The 1-2 pitch. Chopped foul off of Pearson. The bases are loaded. It's Jobert, McManus, and Stevenson aboard. Leto was hit by a pitch to start the inning. Cranford grounded out. And then Jobert and McManus and Stevenson have reached on a walk, an RBI single, and another walk. Pearson cannot find it this time.
Take a look right here. Just that old Uncle Charlie over the top curve. That's the best one that we've seen tonight by Brandon Andrews. That was outstanding.
So two gone for Dylan Cruz. He has two base hits and he's grounded out twice. Cruz this season has hit safely in 35 of 44 games. And he's reached base in every game except two. He does not need a GPS to find his way to first base.
Has not since he arrived on this campus, that's for sure. And good news for LSU fans. He's got one more year before he can be drafted.
This is popped up in foul ground. Trahan is staggering around, but he stabs it for the third out. But LSU gets an RBI single by Tyler McManus and adds to its lead. Two in the second, five in the third, one in the fifth, and one in the sixth for the Tigers. It's 9-0. LSU leads Nicholls.
Applebee's Irresistibles are back, now starting at $8.99. Now that's eating good in the neighborhood.
But it wouldn't be nothing, nothing without a woman or a girl.
Check out this Verbo.
Oh, man. Look at me. Here I am. Right where I belong.
It's all I've been looking for and so much more. And now I'm here. Now you're here. Nothing can go wrong because I am right where I belong.
We love our new apartment.
There's too much pressure in the bathroom.
Good luck with the future in-laws tonight.
Don't overthink it.
But don't underthink it.
At least Geico makes bundling our renters and car insurance easy.
Oh, no.
Oh, boy.
For bundling made easy, go to geico.com.
Nine runs, a dozen hits. Single hit and an error for Nicholls. And LSU has inserted a new shortstop. Cranford, as expected, is the shortstop after replacing Jordan Thompson. Single hit and an error for Nicholls. And LSU has inserted a new shortstop. Cranford, as expected, is the shortstop after replacing Jordan Thompson.